is a venture studio. Which particular applications, which businesses, what industries do you want to disrupt what you grow there?
AI is like electricity 100 years ago. I think it is a position to transform all industries. My friends used to challenge each other, name an industry that AI will not transform, and we actually struggle with that. I once stood on stage and said, maybe hairdressing, can an AI cut someone's hair? But my friend, who was a robotics professor, stood up later and pointed at my head, and she said, Andrew, most people's hair can't get AI to cut their hairstyle, but your hair, Andrew, a robot could totally do that. So I think we're actually going to all sorts of industries today.
Brutal. Your hair looks very nice today. Look, what's so interesting about your background is not only the wider range of companies that you founded, but look, you were Google Brain Team, for example, really at the very beginnings of AI within that particular big beast, also Baidu. I'm interested as to
I started the Google Brain Team. It was great fun, and my team built a lot of Google's modern AI capabilities. Yeah.
So with that, how do you worry about big companies, big corporates, having so much talent, having basically ability to, maybe even negotiate agencies that require licenses going forward? Do you think that we will see a democratization in how AI is grown, or do you think it will be owned by some big companies that already exist?
There are opportunities for both large companies and for new startups. This is where I see the value being generated. There's the hardware layer, companies like NVIDIA, Intel, AMD, maybe new entrants as well. That will create a lot of value. There's the infrastructure layer, including the clouds, as well as the AI tool builders. That looks quite competitive, but also opportunities there. And then the massive untapped opportunity that most people don't realize is the application layer. So I think that AI is a general purpose technology. That means it's not just useful for one thing. I built AI ad systems that moves massive amounts of dollars for some of the large ad tech advertising platforms. But AI isn't just used for ads. It's useful for robotic process automation, medical diagnosis, in agriculture, in manufacturing. And I think it's actually very difficult for any one company to simultaneously build businesses in everything from maritime shipping to education to healthcare to financial services. And so I think the most efficient way to actually realize all of these diverse use cases all across the economy is to build multiple startups to attack these different opportunities. And that's what my venture firm, AI Fund, does. And I think the application layer has a lot of untapped opportunities.
No one company can own all those fields. But what about one country? Everyone seems to have deep anxiety about the so-called race, US versus China. As someone who was at Baidu, how does your expertise instruct that view?
Without speaking to any one country, I feel like most countries at this point in time are probably underinvesting in AI. 10 years ago, we saw the explosion in deep learning, machine learning, basically labeling things, label, what's the text transcript for this label? Will someone click on this ad? Label this medical diagnosis. 10 years later, we've not yet finished sorting out all the valuable use cases where this can be applied. And in the last few years, we now have generative AI, which is another general purpose technology, which again is useful for all sorts of things. And that means that the number of applications to which we can apply AI is even vastly greater than before. This means that for most nations, the next decade will have a lot of opportunities to figure out a lot more concrete use cases to create a lot of value for everyone. And I think, frankly, most countries should invest more into tech and in research and in education around AI.
You wrote quite a strongly worded response, rebuttal, shall we say, to what had been the proposal, the letter, the signatories saying, look, put a halt, put a pause, particularly on generative AI development at the moment and the big large language models. You said in particular it was ill-advised largely because, the genie's out the bottle, but ultimately that, they were unrealistic in the way in which AI could upend humanity, but also we don't want to slow down innovation. Where are you on just how powerful AI could become, or at least where the regulatory landscape is moving at the pace at which innovation is too?
So I think AI does have risks. There is bias, fairness, concentration of power, amplifying toxic speech, generating toxic speech, job displacement. There are real risks that the AI community takes seriously, working on, hopefully, actually for the most part, working really hard to make things better. Then there is the overhyped existential risk, will AI wipe out humanity? I'm less worried about that for a couple of reasons. One, the hard takeoff scenario where AI isn't working that well yet today, but suddenly overnight, May 31st, 2023, we suddenly have sentient super intelligence, and then 48 hours later, it's taken over the world. Technology doesn't work like that. It actually grows gradually, so we'll see it coming. And humanity has lots of experience controlling entities any more powerful than a single human. Corporations and nation states are much more powerful than one person, but we've, you know, for the most part, managed to steer them for the common good. And then lastly, I think humanity does have existential risk. Maybe an asteroid will do to us what it did to the dinosaurs, or climate change leading to massive depopulation. And I think, or the next pandemic, you know, fingers crossed. When I look at the actual existential risk that face humanity, I think AI will be a large part of the solution. So if you want humanity to survive and thrive for the next 1,000 years, I would much rather make AI go faster to help us solve these problems rather than slow AI down.
Well, let's talk about thriving. It's really interesting that one particular sort of public market capitalization that's been upended is the education companies that we see listed. I think of Chegg and how much they started to reference that ChatGPT might be slowing their own growth. You are a man who knows and understands online education thoroughly. You're already developing a way in which you can perhaps retrain, reskill to make engineers prompt engineering developers. How are you seeing the landscape change for tech talent right now?
I think that in the tech talent landscape, I want to share one thing that is really obvious to AI insiders, but is not widely known, which is the rise of AI, things like ChatGPT, not as a consumer tool, but as a developer tool. So many people have tried ChatGPT. If you haven't yet, go try it, or Bard, or the Microsoft Edge Bing search. Fantastic consumer tool. What many people do not yet understand is that these tools are very powerful developer tools as well. And so there were AI systems that used to take teams like a year to build. They can now be built in a day or two. And so a couple of weeks ago, collaborating with OpenAI, my team DeepLearning.AI launched a free online class, ChatGPT prompt programming for developers, to teach people how to use this to program AI capabilities really fast, really quickly. And we actually had 500,000 enrollments in about 2 weeks. Don't know if it was the fastest growing course in the history of online education. But I think that this massive wave of new applications that we can now build much more cheaply and much more quickly is we're just at the start of that. And I think most people have not realized how big a flood of innovation this will cause in AI.